Assalamu alaikum, good afternoon, shalom aleich, and a very good afternoon to everyone, all the viewers, international viewers, I may say, to this very important webinar on Israel's strategy for occupation. As many of you will know, the current situation in the Middle East is getting to a point where people are saying, well, what's changed? Are we just revealing what everybody already knew? There seems to be a host of countries now lining up to come out the closet, or were they already out and this is just the official version? To discuss this and discuss the impact on the region, and more importantly, to discuss the impact on the Palestinian cause, the struggle for freedom, the struggle to remove occupation, the struggle to live in dignity with justice for all people of that area, we've got a fantastic panel of people to present to you. You'd have heard of all of them. They will be introduced one by one. But before I go there, just a couple of points I think is salient to make. When we see what's happening out there in the Middle East with the UAE accepting the new accord, peace accord, as they call it, a peace accord with Israel, and now Bahrain has announced they're doing the same, and I think probably Saudi Arabia. I'll leave the experts to give you their comments on what they think is actually going to happen moving down the timeline. It's quite pertinent and quite rather, you know, this is happening under a time when we have a far-right leader in America, and we have a far-right leader in charge of Israel who happens to court far-right leaders in Europe. So they find this is a great time to befriend these people, even though they belong to the far right. This probably is an indication of how they rule their own countries, possibly, because none of these are democracies. None of these allow people to vote for a government. The UAE has no voting or accountability. Bahrain is an imposed kingship on its people. And Saudi Arabia, well, we all know about that one, don't we? So it looks like we've got basically a group of far right people in charge on finding kinship in the Middle East at the moment. And that is, I think, is quite telling of where we are at this juncture. Also, looking further afield, I think what would be good, we'll probably find out from the speakers as well, is what does the future hold? This is the current situation. Why are they doing it? What are the implications on the region, and specifically on the Palestinian cause and on occupation in the region? What's expected of the activists now to do? What are we meant to do? Is there, can we extend a boycott? Should we be going to the UAE or to Bahrain or whatever, whether it be for business or for holidays, etc., etc.? I know, reading some of the messages. I mean, the other interesting thing was on Twitter, a lot of Bahrainis have spoken up against this normalization ties with Israel. Whereas in the UAE, it was pretty quiet. But the Bahrain, the people have spoken and are speaking consistently on Twitter and saying this is not for them. And they're apologizing on behalf of the government, saying to the Palestinian people, look, we're not with the rulers. And the telling thing about Bahrain, actually, is the fact that I don't think many people are with the rulers, but it's an imposed kingdom on the population, supported by the ones who are very good at it, the British. Who else would you expect? To discuss this, so-called normalization of occupation, we've got, like I said, a host of speakers. Let me just run through who we've got. So we've got Dr. Marwa Osman, we've got Brother Massoud Shadjareh, we've got Reverend Stephen Sizer, we've got Mick Napier, and we've got Professor Haim Bresheeth. So those names mean a lot when it comes to those people who are activists. You've heard of these people. You know how active and at the forefront they are, and how much work, effort, sweat, blood, and tears, may I say, and add, genuinely, that they put into supporting not just the Palestinian cause primarily, but all people looking for freedom and just living to live in peace and dignity. So I think we should start. And I'd like to start off by introducing Professor Haim Bresheeth. His topic is normalization as a weapon. Professor Haim, for those of you who don't know, is a teacher at the School of African and Oriental Studies, otherwise known as SOAS, which is in London. An ex-Israeli Jew and an ardent anti-Zionist, his most recent book is titled an army like no other. How the Israeli Defense Force made a nation. And I think it's a book that we should all read, actually. It's excellent. It's a great read. And Professor, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for inviting me to this august panel. Because I'm just 2 days out of hospital after an operation, I'd like to read my talk, so I'm sticking with the timetable. So first I want to do is to speak of this process of normalization in a historical perspective. It doesn't start in 1948, and it does start with the dawn of Zionism, and is driven by Christian Zionism in Britain and the United States, starting indeed with the Reformation. I promise to be very brief about this. Christian Zionism precedes Jewish Zionism and presages it, depending as it does on religious notions based on the Book of Revelation, the final book of the Christian Bible. In modern, especially US fundamentalist circles, readings of this text, the Jews play a role in the end of days scenario and take their old land of Palestine before they are exiled to hell and the end of days arrives. Thus, in order to bring about the new heaven and earth, the process has to run its course. This is the background. This influenced British political and religious figures greatly in the UK before, especially during the 19th century, leading to a strong Christian Zionist tradition. Now, about this tradition, should read, I think, Professor Noor Masalkha of SOAS. The British elite has developed the new science of archaeology at the time, there to prove the provenance and accuracy of the Bible. Most early British archaeologists were either clergymen, army officers, or both. Such was the group which set up the Palestine Exploration Fund in the 1860s, devoted to the aims of Christian Zionism, as well as advancing British imperial interests. Noor Masalkha has researched this Zionist Christian tendency and its influences on the later Jewish political Zionism of Herzl. Indeed, the mainstream of Judaism in Europe and elsewhere at the time was strongly opposed to Zionism on the basis it was harmful and destructive on a number of religious and civil historical arguments. By definition, Christian Zionism was an elite devoted to furthering the interests of Jewish Zionism as an avatar, an agent, and an outpost of the British Empire in the Middle East, a counterweight to the Arab and Muslim societies in control of the region. So what we are talking about is introducing Jewish Zionism into the Middle East as an agent of colonialism and capitalism and a disinheritor of Arab and Muslim societies. Both main British parties are part of this historical process. Churchill, Asquith, and Balfour were all Christian Zionists, combining a religious reading of history with their interest of controlling the large British Empire. The British Labour Party, as distinguished from most European leftist mass organizations, was greatly influenced by its church tradition of Christian socialism, a branch of Christian Zionism. The Labour Party was, and remains, the most Zionist party in Britain. In that sense, Corbyn represented a temporary divergence from that pattern, followed even by Tony Benn. The party was greatly influenced by the myth of Israeli socialism and the kibbutz movement, disregarding its racist history, theory, and practices, and its crucial role in colonizing Palestine. This is why administrations of both parties carefully followed the Balfour Declaration towards establishing Zionist control of Palestine and avoided democratic elections under the mandate at all costs, despite the fact and because of the fact that this was demanded by Palestinians of all groups. And in avoiding agreement to a democratic election, they brought about the inevitable collapse of the mandate and the Nakba, which resulted in 1948. Now, basically, my argument is that there is nothing new in the process of what is now called normalizing the relationship with the Arab and Muslim world. It is a process that started a long time ago, and we see different iterations of it. And it's a process of basically removing control from Arab and Muslim societies and leaving it more and more in the hand of Western societies and Israel, which acts as its agents. Yeah. Now, for similar reasons, I want to remind you that even the USSR in 1948 and for a few years later supported Zionism. Zionism was riding on the latent Islamophobia inherent in European and Christian societies since the Crusades. And it turned into racism after Reconquista of Spain through the Inquisition, combining hatred for Muslims with the older Judophobia against Jews. This form of Islamophobia has never disappeared from the West and explains the great centrality of the Zionist project for Western regimes of past and present. Now, I want to speak about the beginning of Zionism for a moment. The West had conceived of Zionism as the bulwark of Western capitalism against Islam and the Arab world, and used it to open the Middle East for Western interest. And this is continuing exactly along the lines developed by Herzl over a century ago. In this way, Israel became the Western virus in the region during the Cold War, developing its political outlook as a Western stroke US outpost in the Near East, an agenda gradually adopted by the US, UK, Canada, Australia, apartheid South Africa, and most importantly, the EU. Countries of Arab and Muslim, of the Arab and Muslim world are perceived by the West as untrustworthy allies, there to be exploited and controlled through client regimes like Saudi Arabia, Sadat and Mubarak's Egypt, Saddam's Iraq, and the UAE. That such states were undemocratic played into US hands, of course. The more undemocratic the states are, the easier it is to control the regime. Israel is sold to the rest of the world as the only democracy in the Middle East, and the reliable sheriff, armed and financed by the West, UK, France, Italy, West Germany, and since 1967, the US. Israeli presumed rights over Palestine are seen, as within Zionism, as exclusive and religious-based, with the Holocaust used as a clincher argument. This is very useful because no one seems to be able to say anything about this combination of, Judeo-Christian and Holocaust arguments. Now, post-1948, such developments lead to the crowning of the Israeli franchise over the region in small but decisive phases. Current phase of more and more Arab regimes added to the relationship, direct relationship with Israel, are just the latest phase, which started, as you remember, with Sadat going to Jerusalem and signing an agreement that totally excluded any rights for the Palestinians and Palestine. Since then, in a series of military attacks on the Palestinians and other Arabs, the Israeli hegemony was enforced by the West, and the Arab world is pushed towards normalization of Israeli hegemony and control. This is the very opposite of peace, of course. The Palestinians have no horse in this race. Their rights are systematically denied and their land robbed in stages, pushing more and more of them towards leaving their country, the preferred scenario of Zionism since Herzl. As you know, many Christian Palestinians have already left Palestine over the last 50 years. The number is near the 500,000. Fortunately, most of the Palestinians are there. They are not leaving. And they are not likely to leave because there is nowhere for them to go. I then want to talk about the annexation. I called it the annexation show. This is really a mass media production for Western audiences, designed to be replaced by peace, supposedly, with more Arab states, meaning, in fact, the total removal of Arab support for Palestinian rights of any description, which is the stage we are at the moment. This started in 1949 Rhodes Armistice agreements with Egypt, Syria, and Jordan. And you remember that then these were signed without demanding any rights for the Palestinians. And this continues through the 1956 tripartite attack on Egypt and the 1967 occupation of all Palestine and large sections of Egypt, Jordan, Syria, and Lebanon. The legal annexation starts in 1948 with Israel annexing parts of Palestine by force. The triangle annexed from Jordan is one such example. The defeat of the Arab Spring as a movement towards reforming the Arab world has finally enabled this collapse of Arab support for Palestine. Annexation, always combined with ethnic cleansing and forced expulsions, is a colonial settlement control process, not a mere paper resolution passed by the Knesset. The reality principle, to use Freud's term, is what is important, not the media production. The media production tells us this is new. Actually, there is nothing new about it. It is a continuation of something that started more than a century ago. And to understand it as new is confusing us about what we can do about it. Now, I just want to talk to end about President Trump and his largest and most powerful support bloc, which is the Christian fundamentalists of the South and the Midwest, numbering between 60 and 80 millions, and solidly behind him, with his vice president as a figurehead. This group of religious fundamentalists see the Middle East in terms of the ground zero of Armageddon and the crucial role of the Jews in bringing this about. Thus, they are able to combine deep Judophobia with admiration of Israeli military power and aggression, and its function being the bringing forth of the end of days. Now, to us, this sounds like total madness, but the fact that tens of millions in America believe in it without any doubt should worry us all. The crusader hatred towards Islam is very much alive and is feeding this very neatly. This is an iteration of white supremacism, historically disparaging towards the non-Christian world. Now, it would be useful to point out in conclusion that Israel's new international base of support are a combination of racist and anti-Semitic states in Europe, joined by others in South and North America and Asia, such as the US, India, and Brazil, for example. The common denominator of such regimes is their anti-democratic, racist, militarist, capitalist, and anti-environmentalist agenda, a broad proto- or neo-fascist front, which is today the strongest political force on this planet, and which may yet bring about the gradual destruction of life on Earth. They certainly are working on it. Now, if we don't understand this, we don't understand what we're fighting, and we don't know what we can use to fight it. Most authoritarian Arab regimes fit well into this rubric and fully collaborate with its interests and objectives and support them. In that sense, Israel has become the poster boy of this power base and an icon of its ideology and practices. To defeat Israeli colonialism in Palestine, it will be necessary first to defeat or neutralize the wide-ranging neo-fascist racist coalition which finances, arms, and supports Israel and its war crimes. Now, I know this sounds like an impossible task, and I'm young enough to have joined the anti-apartheid organization against South African apartheid in 1972 when I came to London, and it looked like an impossible task then, because the West and the same group of powers were supporting South Africa, led by the US and UK, of course. I am not saying that it's the same. It is not the same. Israel has now support of groups of countries that were, until recently, acted as if they were its enemies, but they were never enemies of Israel. Saudi Arabia was never an enemy of Israel. The UAE was never an enemy of Israel. Now the broad group that supports Israel as the outpost of capitalism and neocolonialism in the Middle East is supported by most Arab regimes as we speak. It's supported by the largest country, Egypt, the most important state in the Middle East, and the only one that had serious military successes together with Syria in 1973 against Israel. So this looks an impossible task, but it is not. We need to fight it in the way that they are not fighting us. In other words, through non-violent civilian resistance to this regime of Israel and the countries that support it, which means BDS. And when the Israelis say that BDS is a deadly attack on their regime, they are right, because BDS can combine, and I hope will combine, hundreds of millions and possibly billions of people who are now ruled by those regimes and are against it. Exactly like we heard in the introduction, the people of UAE or Qatar or Bahrain or all those countries that are already in this bloc or may soon join it are not behind the regimes. The people of Egypt are not behind Sisi, and we're not behind Mubarak in the support of Israel. The Arab masses are not in support of Israeli colonization. And I believe that even in this country, in the birthplace of British imperialism, people on the whole are supportive of Palestinian rights. It's a bit different in the United States, but even there, the situation changes, and even young Jews whose parents were Zionists are now not Zionists and are not supporting Israel. So please look at those beginnings of resistance. And please remember that the only weapon which we have is a weapon which is very powerful, and that is the total and universal resistance to Zionism and its group of, you know, post and fascist states. And this is what we have to develop universally across the world in order to win the battle. In so doing, we will also win our local battles against fascist regimes, and hopefully the first one will happen in the United States in November. Thank you very much.
I gave Professor Haim the dispensation to go slightly above time, simply because I think he was setting out the agenda of today's webinar really, really well. So thank you, Professor. I'm covering a lot of topics there. There are a lot of takeaways for us as well. And I think what you need to do, what many of us need to do, me included, is to go back when we get time and listen to these again, because you know, it's a lot of academic work Professor Haim presented there as well. So this is all evidence-based. This isn't just some pick it out of sky type of fly-by-night type of thing. This is evidence-based information coming to you based on historical proofs, etc. So it'd be good to re-listen to these talks again and pick out from that what you need to. But the main thing and the main takeaway for me from Professor Haim is keep up the resistance. Let's stand together shoulder to shoulder with everybody else and keep up the good moral fight against fascism, Zionism, and racism. So thank you, Professor Haim. Professor Haim touched on Christian Zionism, which leads us nicely into our next speaker, who is the Reverend Stephen Sizer, who is the author of the book Christian Zionism. Reverend Stephen Sizer will elaborate on how Israel has successfully made inroads into Christian communities in order to normalize the brutality of the occupation. Reverend Stephen Sizer, it's all yours.
Thank you. We're looking at normalization, Israel's strategy for occupation. And I'd like to explore this subject on three headings. First of all, the context. Secondly, the causes. And then thirdly, the challenges. And I will be building on what Professor Haim has already said. And I want to specifically to explore the role Christians have played in this normalization process. So first of all, the context. Well, we can go right back to about 1840 when Lord Shaftesbury issued a full page advert in the London Times calling for the restoration of the Jewish people to the land of Palestine. And so the movement which led to the birth of Zionism, as Professor Haim has said, was preceded by what we call Christian restorationism. And Theodor Herzl is associated with the phrase "a land of no people" for a people with no land. It doesn't actually appear in his writings, but nevertheless, his name is associated with that slogan. It's actually a slogan which Lord Shaftesbury used in 1853, a whole generation before the birth of Zionism. He said, "A country without a nation, for a nation without a country." So that when the Balfour Declaration was published, it indicated the official government position that Britain favored the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people. So that's the context. And I now want to develop the causes. And I just want to say one thing about that word occupation. I have a problem with the word occupation because it implies something that's temporary or transient. I much prefer the word colonization because that, as I've tried to show you from those quotations from Lord Shaftesbury and the Balfour Declaration, the intention was that Britain would facilitate the colonization of Palestine by Jewish people in the same way we were colonizing South Africa, East Africa, the Far East, India, Canada. But what I want to do, secondly, is look at the causes. And it has to do with Christian Zionism, which emerged well before Jewish Zionism. If you allow me a definition, Christian Zionism is a movement within Christianity that views the modern state of Israel as the fulfillment of biblical prophecy from Genesis right through to Revelation. And therefore, it gives a mandate to Christians to support Israel economically, morally, politically, and religiously. And if you're not aware of this movement or skeptical, let me quote to you Benjamin Netanyahu. In 2012, he said, quote, "I don't believe that the Jewish state and modern Zionism would have been possible without Christian Zionism." He said, "We value our friends and we will never forget them. And we think that you have helped establish here a powerful memorial to our friendship and common ideals." So when Donald Trump was elected president, Jerry Falwell Jr. said, "I think evangelicals have found their dream president, reuniting Israel with America." And when Mike Pompeo was asked whether he thought Donald Trump was like biblical Queen Esther, who saved the Jews in Persia, he said, quote, "As a Christian, I certainly believe that's possible." John Hagee is the founder of Christians United for Israel, Kufi. And he said this, he said, quote, "The sleeping giant of Christian Zionism has awakened. There are 50 million Christians standing up and applauding Israel. Think of our future together. 50 million evangelicals joining in common cause with 5 million Jewish people in America on behalf of Israel is a match made in heaven." Now, what is their agenda? Well, the normalization agenda of the Christian Zionist lobby has at least five or six dimensions. And the first is lobbying on behalf of Israel. There's a close relationship between the Israeli government and Christian Zionist organizations. You have Christian Friends of Israel, the International Christian Embassy, Jerusalem, Bridges for Peace, Jerusalem Prayer Team, Christians United for Israel. They are the drivers of these 50 or more million Christians in the USA who identify themselves as Christian Zionists. In Britain, we have Anglican Friends of Israel, Catholics for Israel, Baptists for Israel, Quaker Friends of Israel, Pentecostal Focus on Israel. And they're all active in advocating, lobbying, pressuring, and monitoring critics of Zionism too. So that's the first element of their agenda, lobbying on behalf of Israel. Secondly, they're active in funding the emigration of Jews to Palestine. So for example, the International Christian Embassy has been involved for over 30 years in funding the transportation of Jewish people from Russia, Eastern Europe, Ethiopia. They have assisted over 150,000 Jewish emigres make aliyah to Palestine, and most recently assisting Ethiopian Jews to move to Palestine. The third element of their strategy is supporting the illegal settlements. There is an organization called Christian Friends of Israeli Communities, CFOIC. They have a website, returnoisrael.org, and they are active in campaigning for the legitimization of the settlements. They fund the settlements. They encourage churches to adopt settlements. They use language like Israeli communities. They talk about Judea and Samaria. They're even involved in assisting the Israeli army, particularly individuals, US citizens, for example, who go and serve in the Israeli army and don't have a family to go to at weekends. But this lobbying on behalf of the settlements was culminated in Donald Trump's recognition that the settlements form part of the state of Israel. So lobbying, funding, supporting the settlements, and then fourthly, moving of embassies to Jerusalem, recognizing Jerusalem as the exclusive, undivided, eternal capital of Israel. Back in 1980, the International Christian Embassy in Jerusalem was founded with that express purpose. And since the 1980s, they and others have been campaigning and lobbying the US administration to move their embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, knowing that if the US does, everyone else will follow suit and undermine any notion of Jerusalem being an international city or a shared capital. Donald Trump made moving the embassy to Jerusalem one of his campaign pledges. And quite recently, after that embassy was opened in Jerusalem, he made this observation. He said, quote, "We moved the capital of Israel to Jerusalem. That's for the evangelicals." You know, it's amazing with that. The evangelicals are more excited by that than the Jews, unquote. So moving the US embassy was really to solidify the exclusive claim to Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. The fifth element of their normalization strategy is accusing critics of anti-Semitism. And so we've seen the rise in the last 10, 15 years of Zionist groups equating anti-Zionism with anti-Semitism. Most recently, Lord Jonathan Sachs appeared on BBC Newsnight insisting that anti-Zionism is the new anti-Semitism. And just last year, the Church of England adopted, the bishops adopted the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, the IHRA definition of anti-Semitism, along with the Labour Party, Conservatives, and so on. So we have the lobbying on behalf of Israel, funding the settlements, funding the immigration of Jews, supporting the settlements, moving the embassies, accusing critics of anti-Semitism. And finally, we find this normalization agenda involves a perpetuation of the conflict because Christian Zionists are convinced that Israel must not compromise its claim to all of Palestine. Hal Lindsey, for example, is probably the most prolific Christian writer, a Christian Zionist writer. He said this a few years ago. He said, quote, "I am heartbroken over the latest stage of the roadmap to peace, the Odyssey to Holocaust. I was sickened to watch a well-meaning Christian president talk incessantly about his vision." Now, just think about it. What would make you feel sick about a president talking about his vision? The vision, Hal Lindsey says, is for, quote, "a Palestinian and Jewish state living side by side in peace." That's what made him feel sick. And John Hagee said recently, "It is 1938, Iran is Germany. We must stop Iran's nuclear threat and stand boldly with Israel." This is a Christian minister. His church, 20,000 members, access, as I said, to these 50 million evangelicals. He said this, quote, "Iran is a clear and present danger to the US and Israel. It is time for our country to consider a military preemptive strike against Iran if they will not yield to diplomacy." So you have Christian ministers calling upon the US to attack Iran and other countries preemptively. It's shocking, really. That's the context. We've looked at the causes and finally the challenges. Well, the challenges come from the response to this normalization comes from the church leaders in Jerusalem. And there are a number of organizations that are active in this, the Kairos movement, the Sabeel Kairos movement in the UK, the BDS movement is, as Professor Haim mentioned, the non-violent resistance to normalization is the way forward. We've seen some success in the Ahava campaign, Caterpillar, G4S. But let me just conclude with two short quotes that summarize how I believe we must challenge this normalization process. Martin Luther King said this, quote, "Nonviolence is a powerful and just weapon. It is a weapon unique in history, which cuts without wounding. It is a sword that heals." And lastly, Desmond Tutu said this, "The end of apartheid stands as one of the crowning accomplishments of the past century, but we would not have succeeded without the help of international pressure. If apartheid ended," he said, "so can this occupation, but the moral force and the international pressure will have to be just as determined." That was Desmond Tutu. Normalization, Israel's strategy for colonization. That's why we are challenging this today. Thank you.
Reverend Stephen, thank you so much for another informative talk. I like the way you brought out the word occupation and changed it with colonization. I think that makes perfect sense. And thanks for delving into the nitty-gritty, if you will, of Christian Zionism. It's really good to see where the base of this is and where the current support is, especially how it's being led by 50 million, as you say, over in the US, and they've got a dream president to deliver for them. But again, like you said as well at the end, we've got to be determined, and our job is to, like you said, resist. Our job is to stand up, and our job is to use our mouths and talk and to use our pens and our papers and whatever media and technology we can in order to tell the truth in all ways, shapes, and forms. So thank you so much, Reverend Stephen. Our next speaker, Dr. Marwa Osman, whose title of the talk will be Normalization with Arab States. Dr. Marwa Osman is a political commentator on issues within West Asia and university lecturer at the Lebanese International University, the Maaref University. She has featured on several international and regional media outlets, including RT, Press TV, Al Manar and Al Alam. So, Dr. Marwa, welcome. Thank you for gracing us with your presence and your insight. And we look forward to your talk on normalization with Arab states. Maybe that's an oxymoron, you can tell us.
Well, thank you for the kind invitation, and thank you for having us on such a platform with very I'd like to commend what both professors, the professor and the reverend, began by talking about Christian Zionism, how the history played into all of this that we are now living through. And I have a couple of comments on what they have said before I go into my my part of this webinar concerning two very important issues they mentioned, which is Christian Zionism being before Zionism itself, and about the nonviolent resistance. I do agree, obviously, with both, but I have something to add to both. We listened to the history, how it all started, and it's interesting to see how it now it's elaborating into the Muslim world and creating a new group of Muslim Zionists who serve the greater agenda of Zionism in the region. And I'm speaking here about the role of Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, the UAE, Qatar, etc., and those that began before that in Egypt and Jordan as well. But what I mean by the Muslim Zionists of our age, which are represented by the regimes in the Persian Gulf Arab states, this you know, their reaction towards the causes of our area, our West Asian area, from the occupation of Palestine to the invasion of Beirut and further on to the invasion of Iraq and then to the world war against Syria. All of this were just maybe pre and preemptive or pretext to what they're about to do now. And had it not been for the failure of the revolution in Syria, we would have seen also the new regime in Syria also normalizing with the Israeli regime in occupied Palestine. What I mean by having this new form of Muslim Zionism, which is very new to the Islamic teachings, to the Arab dignity, because it was always honor and dignity in the culture of the Arab world that prevented any sort of, first of all, maybe tribal wars, and further on, other state invading your own state. It's always dignity and honor. They have managed to remove those two values, if you will, from the current, the postmodern Arab citizen who agrees and is happy, like those in the UAE, for example, versus those who are in Bahrain who tried to start a revolution against the US and Saudi imposed regime and failed. And still yet yesterday we saw them trending, saying we are against the normalization that our regime is imposing. Yet the role for these new people is very vital to the survival of the Zionist entity in our region. Now, the second point concerning the nonviolent resistance and how it's a very important weapon, I do agree very much, in order to maybe push the international community to hold more pressure against the international institutions like the UN, the EU, and other alliances around the world to stop the annexation, to stop the violations and aggressions against the people of Palestine, to stop the human rights violations as well, and other areas in the region, because we still have occupied land in Lebanon, occupied land in Syria, etc. It's very important, but it is not possible without the vital presence of local armed resistance. Thus was the case also in South Africa. Without those who were trying with arms to fight off the aggression, it was not possible to complete it without international community pressure. This is where I want to start my my speech about this issue to begin with. Our problem in the region, in West Asia, specifically in Syria and Lebanon, was the presence of armed resistance against the Zionist entity, which pushed it out of our borders in 2000, exactly like what the professor was saying at the beginning when the movement of support for apartheid against apartheid South Africa started in the 70s. It was like an impossible mission. And exactly the same thing happened in Lebanon when we had an invasion in 1982, preceded by a Lebanese civil war into a full aggression Israeli war against Lebanon. I don't need to talk about that that era of time. You can always find it. It's obviously out there. But what is very important is, starting 1984 up until 2000, had it not been for the weapons of the actual resistance on the ground, I wouldn't be right now in my village house at the border with occupied Palestine. Occupied Palestine is just in my face, and occupied Golan Heights is to my left. I wouldn't be here right now. My kids wouldn't be enjoying the nature that they should be enjoying. It's the land of their ancestors. So it's very vital to understand that also supporting the local armed resistance against this aggression, the Zionist aggression, is that the people of the West Asian area is vital with international pressure. They need to be together, and it's vital for the international community as well to help us, the communities who are resisting, who are at the front line against Israel, to help us from stopping the sanctions imposed by the US, the UK, and their European allies, to stop demonizing the resistance, to stop also demonizing the allies of the resistance. We also, 2 days ago, when allies of the resistance in Lebanon were sanctioned, they were not even part of Hezbollah. They were sanctioned because they are allies of Hezbollah in Lebanon. So also this kind of international pressure against the empire and its allies also helps us a lot. Now, to talk about the normalization at the level of the Arab states and the Muslim world in our part of the world, it was not obviously a surprise, because if you lived in this area, if you have been here basically since the 60s up to this point, you can see that the regimes in our area in West Asia were already normalizing with the Israeli entity. They were obliged to do so because they are under occupation themselves, political occupation and military occupation by the United States of America, especially after World War II, when the US came along and took over the position of the UK in West Asia and basically in the Arabian Peninsula, and they took control of that area. We have the biggest Fifth Fleet, the American Fifth Fleet in Bahrain. We have the Udaid Air Base in Qatar. We have air bases that we don't know about in South Arabia, but were proven to exist after the war in Yemen, when even American warplanes took part in bombing and carpet bombing Yemenis as well. And also you have military bases in Jordan and Egypt. Egypt's not allowed to have certain kind of weaponry if the U.S. doesn't allow it, because, well, to their north is the precious Israeli regime. And likewise, a lot of other countries that fell into the hands of the United States after, especially after the Iraq, the invasion of Iraq in 2003, up until now, we're still seeing the ramifications of this occupation, which is still going on. Yet, we heard a couple of days ago about the troop cuts that Trump is trying to do, which all obviously is shown to be part of his electoral campaign. But again, while all of these things are happening, there was a militarized resistance happening against the U.S. Occupation in the region and against the Israeli occupation as well. And within the communities of the countries that are now normalizing, there was great support for the Palestinian cause. People were taking in their schools. You have kids bringing their lunch money, taking out of their lunch money, donating for the Palestinian cause. It still happens in areas that are now normalizing with Israel. The people are still very much wanting to help the Palestinians, but they cannot be vocal about it because obviously they will be arrested. We did see a couple of cases yesterday night when Bahrainis tried to use Twitter to voice their support to Palestinians. We heard a lot of our friends speaking about house raids to arrest those activists. So we're obviously talking about a dictatorship trying to impose such kind of a normalization with a cancerous entity that has nothing to do with the region or the people of the region. Now, speaking about what the UAE did before that, how Qatar had opened diplomatic ties with the Israeli regime. And after that, when Trump came to office, how he pushed the agenda, the obvious covert agenda that was happening between Saudi Arabia and Israel, he pushed it out to the public with the deal of the century and with a bit of easing of regime change inside of Saudi Arabia itself by bringing such a fresh face, if you will, like Mohammed bin Salman to the regime in Saudi Arabia, who in all meaning of a coup, Saudi Arabia went through a coup in the past 3 years to change the entire royal regime in order to favor a full out agreement and normalization with Israel. Add to that, when you have Oman, Sultan of Oman, before he passed away, he received Benjamin Netanyahu in his first ever Arab visit to an Arab state, and it was obvious that Oman was supposedly going to be the first maybe Arab state to normalize with the Israelis, but something went off after the decease of the Sultan of Oman, and it shifted to the United Arab Emirates. But this, all of this would not have been able to happen has it not been for what is now known as the Arab Spring. I like to call it the Arab Sting. It has nothing to do with springs. But all of the history that was given out by the good people before me, the Reverend and the professor, shows that this area, West Asian area, alongside with North Africa, has been part of a complete plan of colonialism since before the UK left the area for the US. So we are still part of the greatest Zionist plan. getting into the second half of the 20th century and into the first half of the 21st century, some of the plans were put into delay because of the presence of resistance communities, whether in Lebanon or in Syria, when we had the war between Egypt and Syria on the one side and Israel on the other, and then the fallout by the Egyptians, Syria was left alone, and it became the only valid route for the current resistance, the current viable, vital, necessary, and only resistance in the face of Israel in the region, which is the Islamic resistance in Lebanon. Syria was the basically covering the back of the resistance, and then we started seeing the direct help of Iran, which now is being put in place by the Israelis as the most dangerous factor in the region that is very much threatening the actual existence of Israel in occupied Palestine. All of these events happening altogether throughout the past 30 to 40 years brought us up to what we are now today in the midst of this huge propaganda of normalization at the level of the regimes, but that has nothing to do with the actual desires of the citizens of this area. And what was very vital to show that the people in this area are against the cancerous presence of Israel or the cancerous presence of the empire occupation on our lands was what happened at the beginning of 2020 with the assassination of General Qasem Soleimani and his brother Haj Abu Mahni al-Muhandis, who are very vital to the axis of resistance, the entire axis of resistance in the region. And they are very vital to the resistance against the U.S. in Iraq and the resistance against U.S. proxies in Syria and the basic resistance against Israel in South Lebanon. After the assassination of these two very vital commanders, we saw an exceptional unity among the communities in West Asia that goes from Iran all the way to Morocco, down to Yemen, even up to Turkey. It was the first time in history, in modern history, that we see such a steadfast community of resistance against all this plan that has been put in place, this colonial plan that has been put in place for the people of West Asia. This by itself gave a great push for the people to stand heavier together, despite the fact that this was a grave loss, but it gave a bit of hope that we can actually get together, unite together, work together in order to maybe push for some change to help our brothers in Palestine, to help them get rid of the constant aggression, for example, in Gaza, to lift the blockade in Gaza, to stop the continuous annexation of new land in the West, in the West Bank, and to stop the apartheid system of apartheid in Al-Quds and all throughout to the region right here in South Lebanon. I can no longer see Palestine except in certain areas because of the huge wall that is now erect because of the Zionist entity. To wrap it up, when we talk about the effect of such a normalization coming from such dictatorial regimes in the West Asia, it is important to also emphasize that these regimes had really no choice but to abide by what the Trump administration demanded them to do. It was either their wealth, money, and royalty, or this acceptance and this agreement. So this agreement by itself gives us hope, the people who are against this agreement, the people who are against the Zionist occupation and the illegal colonial settlers in occupied Palestine, it gives us hope that if this regime is now abiding that much by every literal demand coming from the empire, this just signals to us that their demise is near. And when I mean their demise is near, how can that be possible? It can be possible when the people get fed up by these regimes. When you have human rights violations in Saudi Arabia, you have human rights violations in the United Arab Emirates. In Saudi Arabia, you're not allowed to own a land, even if you are a Saudi, to build your own house. And now the graver part is your own dignity, your own Islamic values are being hit by such agreements with the only enemy that you have in the region, which is the Israeli entity. Same goes to Bahrain and the United Arab Emirates. And something very important that we should not miss was said by the Kuwaitis who refused to take part in this agreement. This shows that the GCC has a big fracture in it, this also can be pushed upon. Now, I want to wrap up the entire thing to talk about the non-violent ways that we can use, all of us, all across the world, that we can use in order to help to get international pressure against the normalization and against the presence of the Israeli entity itself. We have started something called the Islamic and Arab Assembly for the Choice of Resistance in the entire region in West Asia. Now we are 2 weeks away from going global. And what I mean going global is we have coordinates in all continents of our world. And now we're trying to go global, turn it from an Islamic and Arab to a global assembly to support the choice of resistance. And we say the choice of resistance because we want the violent and the non-violent. Violent meaning the resistance on the ground. We support their right to defend themselves. But at the same time, we support the right for BDS. We support the right for international rallies and international support for Palestine and the Palestinians all across the world. So this might actually be a great platform to have everyone involved right now with us to be part of this new global assembly to support the choice of the resistance. And we are starting by getting direct help from our friends at the DNC in South Africa, who agreed to be part of this and to teach us how they were able to rally the international community to support their cause. I want to thank you very much. I'm sorry if I took a bit of more time than I was supposed to. Thank you for having this webinar, and I look forward to hearing your whatever, if you have questions and if you have any comments, I'm happy to hear. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I do apologize. Dr. Marwa Osman, thank you so much for your talk there on normalization with Arab states. You picked on the topics of political occupation, which is also military occupation, which is going on with these regimes at the moment and where the US is occupying them. And you also touched on a point, we think many of us who've visited Western Asia, that the actual groundswell of opinion amongst the average person is pro-Palestinian. It is for the rights of the Palestinians to for them to be able to seek justice and to be able to stand up and live in dignity and peace and security. And it is by nature anti-Zionist. And that is what I would think, based on my travels in the Middle East, I'm sure many of us will share that. Is what we find when we speak one-to-one. They're very careful what they say and where they say it. But when you scratch the surface, that's what comes up. But we've got a top-down thing going on. That's going on now. Imposed peace is the way. So thank you so much again, Dr. Marwa. And it's great to hear about the initiatives. And South Africa, I think, is a great place to learn from. I think we can all learn from their struggles and how they managed to galvanize the global community, together with BDS and all the other great movements out there, which are standing up for the rights of the Palestinians. Thank you, Dr. Marwa. Moving on to our next speaker, to Mick Napier, whose talk is going to be on normalization in the political realm. Mick, many of us know him. Many of us have seen him around the whole of the UK. Is currently the chair of the Scottish Palestine Solidarity Campaign. He's a lifelong campaigner and supporter of Palestine. And Mick has faced, like many, but I think Mick has faced even more so than most, attacks by the Zionist lobby, which have not been very, very pleasant at all. So Mick, you're a trooper, and over to you on your talk on normalization in the political realm. If you could unmute yourself, Mick, please.
Oh, thank you. Nazim, thanks for having me. Thanks to the comrades for having me to follow after the other guests and make a few points. Two corrections. One, I'm no longer chair of Scottish Palestine Solidarity Campaign. I'm still very active in the campaign, but we have a younger generation of people and leaders coming forward. Secondly, it's not at all painful to be attacked by the Zionists here in Britain. The cost of resistance is extremely small, is modest, and it's actually an honour and a pleasure to be singled out by such creatures for attack, sustained attack, vicious attack. But, you know, these people can't touch us because they are the defenders of Israeli snipers mowing down Palestinians on the Gaza periphery for demonstrating for their human rights. I was asked to prepare a contribution for 10 minutes. I think it'll be about that. And let me make a few points about the Middle East and then talk about the implications of the Israeli strategy for normalization domestically here in the UK and in similar countries. I think the first thing to point out is to add to what previous speakers have said, Haim Bresheeth, there's nothing abnormal about the collaboration between Arab regimes and the Zionists. When Palestine was conquered, 78% of it was conquered by Zionist militias and ethnic cleansing gangs in 1948. Most of the fighting was preceded by a meeting between Golda Meir and the Jordanian King Abdullah, where they agreed to divide up Palestine. They agreed on the main lines of division. They agreed the Palestinians would not be taken into account in that division. And they agreed that they might fight around the edges, but that the basic division would be, if they held to those areas, there would be no fighting. So the Palestinians, the Palestinian Nakba, the catastrophe, the agony of Palestine, was birthed not just by the Zionists with, of course, British unstinting backing, but also by the Jordanian regime and a lot of skullduggery by the various Arab regimes who pretended in some cases to come to the aid of the Palestinians. Fast forward 30 years to the Egyptian peace treaty with Israel. It's a very cold peace treaty. It's an agreement between the two regimes, the Egyptian essentially a dictatorship, over the Egyptian people, keeping them in misery and poverty and ill health, and the Zionist regime of ethnic cleansing. That peace treaty was sealed in 1979, but it's extremely cold. Everybody knows, the Zionists are aware, the Egyptian regime is aware, that there is no significant backing for this from the Egyptian population. And wasn't it glorious when shortly after the huge demonstrations in Tahrir Square against Mubarak, we saw huge demonstrations outside the Israeli embassy in Cairo. I don't know if any of you remember, but I certainly remember Spider-Man, apparently an Egyptian building worker who scaled the outside of this monstrous building where the embassy had had to be held up on the very top of this high building, and to a huge crowd assembled below, removed the Israeli flag to huge cheers. A very cold peace, not just with the Egyptian regime and the solid hostility of its people, but with any other Arab regimes which open an embassy in Tel Aviv or even Jerusalem. And there are very strong and solid reasons for that, which go much deeper than a particular government or a particular regime. I mean, Israel and the United Arab Emirates are in a sense made for each other. Israel is a settler colonial regime based on the ethnic cleansing, the great violence against the native people, the Palestinian Arabs, to be replaced by Zionists from around the world. And there isn't any limit to that. The current plan, of course, the plan all along has been that the Zionists will seize 100% of Palestine. This is clear from memoirs, not just Herzl, Ben-Gurion, and all the other leaders of the ethnic cleansing program of the Israeli state, but it's very clear from their behavior. Not a week has gone by since 1948 and earlier where land has not passed from Palestinian ownership and control and been seized by the Zionist state, exclusively for the use and benefit of Jews, where Palestinians may not even buy it. And there have been some very unusual and rare occasions when a couple of Zionists have been, some Israeli Jews, have been struck by conscience, pangs of conscience, and have tried to either sell or give their land back to its original owners, its current owners, Palestinians. But this is illegal under Israeli law. And that movement of land from Palestinian ownership to Israeli ownership has progressed inexorably and has never been reversed. So Israel's a settler colonial state. It necessarily, and you know, the pioneers of Zionism, Jabotinsky, the heirs of the predecessors of Netanyahu's current, were very clear about it. It could only be achieved by naked violence, by an overwhelming edge in the disposition of the means of violence, such that the victims could not fight back. And that necessarily incurs the hatred and wrath of local people. They wouldn't be human if they didn't. And that means that the ethnic cleansing program, the settler program, must rely on the imperial power. And someone once said very, very clearly, very perceptively, Zionism is unable to exist in its present form on its own, but it's not for sale, it's only for hire. And so Zionism accepted the tutorship of the Brits up until 1945 and then switched their main allegiance to the USA. But they always needed the protection of an imperial power. And that today takes the form of, takes many forms, but one of the forms is billions in dollars of aid from the US to Israel, without which it could not continue in its present form. So it's very, very dependent upon imperial patronage and protection. And the UAE and other Gulf Emirates similarly report to the same head office for a different dynamic. They have masses of oil, which for a very long time has control of this, has been coveted by Western powers, by the USA. Control of that is not only needed to fuel American factories, but control of that oil through client states controls access to that oil by the Chinese or the Japanese in the past. It gives a huge edge in international competition. But many of these states have vast amounts of oil and very tiny populations or very small populations. I mean, the UAE, together with the Saudis, has been trying to crush the people of Yemen now in a horrendous war, where the overwhelming technological advantage lies in Abu Dhabi and Riyadh. But they've been unable to prevail against, I think, possibly the poorest Arab country and one of the poorest countries in the world. They've simply failed to defeat the resistance there. And that tells us something. It tells us why the Saudis, confronted by the Saddam regime with ambitions in Kuwait, had to call on American troops, had to call on 500,000 American troops to come to that area in order to sustain the regime and defeat the Saddam regime. The UAE, Bahrain, Qatar, Saudi Arabia don't have the stability to survive long term. They absolutely need the protection of the imperial power in their present form, and therefore they come together. Why do they come together at the moment? Well, I think it's probably to do with the USA withdrawing missile batteries from Saudi recently. Trump talking about withdrawing large amounts of troops, 1,000 troops or so on. And the well-known inclination of the USA at the moment to begin to focus its attention on Asia against its main world challenger, China, and therefore to draw down its presence, if you like, its military interest in what we call the Middle East. And that means that the Saudis are getting nervous, the UAE is getting nervous, and they think that Israel, quite rightly, is an extension of US power into the region. And if the USA is winding down its activity in the region militarily, then they really need to ingratiate themselves. They need to work out something with the regime in Tel Aviv. And I think that's a major factor. I was reading recently, by the way, just to underline the normality, the relationship between Israel and its imperial masters, its imperial protectors. Earlier, friends Haim and Stephen spoke about Christian Zionism. It's quite interesting to think of a guy called Ord Wingate, a real military, a bit of a genius, a complete brute, whom the British put into Palestine in 1936 to crush the Great Palestinian Revolt. He never travelled anywhere without a Bible. He was a determined Christian Zionist. Moshe Dayan said, and he should know a thing or two about mass murder, he said, everything we know we learned from Ord Wingate. Ben-Gurion said he was all set to become the chief of staff of the Israeli army after the ethnic cleansing of 1948, but for the fact that he was killed several years earlier. He was the man who trained the Israeli army in its current brutality. Let me share a quote from a British military historian, Matthew Hughes, who wrote a book called Britain's Pacification of Palestine, in which he described what Britain did in 1936 to 39 to crush the Palestinian revolt, to fasten the Zionist community there on the Palestinians as much as possible. Hughes wrote that the British detained and impoverished during this heightened oppression, restrained, detained and impoverished Palestinians, hanged and killed them, demolished their homes, banned newspapers, interned people, fined and exiled them, censored their mail and telephone calls, took away livestock and crops, whipped them, imposed curfews and police posts, exacted servile labor, corvée labor, restricted travel, made singing, shouting, and waving flags illegal. Many walking down the wrong side of the street was banned, buying a toy children's gun. He says people paid a financial bond to ensure their own good behavior going into the future. If they had a nice house, the authorities marked it for destruction if a stranger in the neighborhood broke the law. He says there are photographs, I'll finish. He says there are photographs in regimental archives showing soldiers painting big numbers on Palestinian buildings for future destruction. This was the British legacy to Palestine. Everything we see the Israelis doing to the Palestinians today, demolishing houses, killing, whipping, beating, violating in every conceivable way, was something they learned from the British, from the and very specifically from the Christian Zionist Ord Wingate. And I think that relationship of tutor to pupil, of protector to sort of inferior power, remains the relationship between the USA and Israel to this day. Another example of this is that of the relationship comes from the fact that Israel, before 1967, actually received very modest amounts of US aid. When they fought Egypt, Syria, and Jordan, it was French aircraft that were used. It was the British and the French who gave them the materials to build their secret nuclear capability, the heavy water and so on. It didn't come from the USA. US aid to Israel rose exponentially after 1967, not before, but after 1967, when Israel proved at that time that it could roundly defeat three Arab armies and defeat Arab nationalism, the idea at that time that Arab people should control oil and other resources. Only after that did America move in wholeheartedly with money, not with words, but with money, in order to back Israel. Because at that time, America was bogged down in Vietnam. It was only a few months away from the massive crisis of the Tet Offensive. And the idea of not putting American boots on the ground, but using Israeli boots was very effective. And there's another point to be made. The US is pulling back from Saudi Arabia to some degree at the moment. I mean, Trump is defending the man who chops up and dissolves his opponents in acid in the Istanbul consulate. But Mohammed bin Salman's running into a bit of trouble in the Congress. There are some forces in the American elite who think that he's unreliable. Not that he's brutal and cruel. They were all brutal and cruel leaders of Saudi Arabia. But also he doesn't quite follow his masters in detail. He's a bit unpredictable, and he might just actually go too far and fall. And I think that's part of a more general attitude from Washington towards the Middle East. And I think we need to recognize this, that Israel has the USA has Arab regimes as client regimes, the UAE, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, and so on. But the US does not, the CIA estimates, do not build in their long-term viability. The US needs client regimes of empire in every region, South Asia, South America, the Middle East, and what we call the Middle East, forgive me. But they don't think that these Arab regimes are stable enough. They know that they can fall. They know that there can be a wave of uprisings which will remove these regimes, which are deeply unpopular, which become even more unpopular when they align themselves closely with Israel. And Israel is different. Israel is a settler colonial regime. Israel is tied umbilically to America at the moment for its very survival, and therefore will fight on behalf of the USA when it needs to. And I think that means that even when those Arab regimes begin to fall, for a while, not forever, but for a while, the American commitment to Israel will remain solid, because Israel doesn't have options and is tied to Washington. And as the US, but at the moment, to fast forward to the present period, as the US interest in the Middle East weakens, shall we say, then we have to look at what's Israel's strategy for normalization. One, to build links with these despotic regimes which are way above their own populations. They don't even dream of giving people fixed and stable political rights in Saudi Arabia or in Bahrain or in Oman. The Israeli strategy in that situation is to build links to those regimes. And at the moment, they've got a green light, and it's very likely that more will line up behind. I think Kosovo in Europe is going to open an embassy, and the UAE and Saudi Arabia probably will not be far behind. But here's the problem, and I think it's a fundamental problem, that even though Israel is making friends among the dictatorships of regimes in the region, it remains a pariah state worldwide. And I don't say that poetically or because I wish it to be true. While Israel has a strategy to take the entire land surface of Palestine with very, very few, if any, Palestinians, its behavior is such that it's seen, certainly in an age of social media, by populations around the world, in the Middle East, of course, but also around the world to a great extent, as doing something terribly wrong. And I just give two examples of that. Since 2000, back in 2003, the EU conducted a poll of its citizens in every country, well-financed, organized by the EU. They realized later they'd made a mistake, but they did it. And they measured what people across the EU thought of many different countries. They gave them a list of countries and said, rank them in order of what you think's a threat to world peace. Israel came top in every country. 59% on average of Europeans said Israel was the greatest threat to world peace. It wasn't what the EU had expected. It's what they got. Franco Frattini, the EU spokesman for foreign affairs, apologized to Israel on behalf for the opinions of European citizens. And he guaranteed Israel that these opinions of Europe, this public opinion, he said, would not influence EU policy towards the apartheid regime. Since 2003, it hasn't got any better for Israel. It's become worse. the reason's obvious. The murder has become worse. Operation Cast Lead, Operation Protective Edge, many other lesser but still substantial massacres of Palestinians. And report after report after report from the UN, from Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and so on, that Israel is deliberately killing Palestinians who pose no threat, not even people involved in the resistance, but is deliberately killing, the UNHCR recently said, deliberately killing children, knowing that they are children, disabled, very high-profile medical workers, journalists, and so on. And that means that the 2003 result hasn't got any better for Israel. It's got worse. The BBC, I don't usually trust it to say anything, although I do rely on the weather forecast, and there are a couple of scientific programs that are pretty good, but you can't trust the BBC at all. But the BBC World Service Radio does an international annual survey of what people think of different countries. Now, countries that are demonized by our governments don't do very well. Israel is massively massaged by our media and by our governments. Their murders are covered up as much as possible. Their crimes are either ignored and protected behind a veil, or they're dealt with as if it's a tragic necessity. Israel always comes very, very near the bottom of these countries in terms of what people actually think. There are other surveys of popular opinion, which if you had a million quid, you could commission the people to do it for you. But seriously, reliable scientifically, Israel is bad news in terms of what ordinary people think in their millions in every single country. And that's why the second strand of the Israeli policy for normalization is to suppress opposition. There's no choice. They have to do that. And we see this in Britain. We see the defeat of Jeremy Corbyn and Corbynism for the moment through an alliance of vested interests, Conservative Party, right-wing Labour, major corporations, and led by the Zionist bodies in the UK, smearing Jeremy Corbyn, not as having some passion for justice for the Palestinians, but waking up in the morning and hating Jews. As Jews. It's madness. It's completely crazy stuff. And no intelligent person actually believes it, but it is dominant in public discourse and has been for a very long time. And that was used to destroy the left in the Labour Party. And more widely in local government and elsewhere, the current government in Britain, I mean, Boris Johnson calls himself a passionate Zionist, which is fitting given his other vices. The Home Secretary, Priti Patel, was fired by her boss, Theresa May, when she went to Israel a couple of years ago and secretly had meetings with Israeli officers and political figures, came back to Britain and suggested that British humanitarian aid, which is already suspect in many ways, but that should be directed towards the Israeli military. Selling sniper rifle parts to the Israeli military wasn't enough for her. She wanted humanitarian aid to go to the people who were using those sniper rifles. So where we are now, I think, is that Israel is powerful militarily, is now finding diplomatic allies among local regimes, but is a polecat regime around the world. How can we go forward? The previous speaker is absolutely right. Anybody who doesn't support the right of colonial peoples to resistance by any means that they choose is a rascal. And certainly those living in Europe are racists, because nobody challenges the right of French resistance or the Italian partisans or the Yugoslav partisans during World War II to resist occupation by a foreign army. If you deny that right to Arabs and other peoples in the Middle East, it can only be because of racism, because you consider that they don't enjoy the same rights as white people. So that right has to be conceded. But there is another, there's another massively powerful weapon as well. And that is what other speakers have alluded to. Mass involvement in boycott, divestment and sanctions and isolating the state of Israel. And I'm very proud of the fact that no Israeli state-sponsored group can come to the biggest arts festival on the planet, the Edinburgh Festival. If they do, they're protested out in double quick time.
Mick, thank you for that.
Finish by making two.
Sure. Okay. Sure.
Have I run out of time or can I make two quick points?
Just make it one if you don't mind, Mick, if you don't mind. What's going on?
We do not know to what extent our solidarity action will reduce the cost of the high price of freedom, but reduce it to some degree for the Palestinians and the other people of the Middle East. But reduce it will, to an uncalculable degree. But we know that it will make a difference, and the international solidarity movement can reduce the cost of freedom for the Palestinians and the other people of the Middle East. Thank you.
Mick, thank you so much, really. Thank you. And I know it's easy to get into this because there's so much to be said. Unfortunately, there's so much suffering, there's so much oppression going on of the Palestinian people. And because it's been covered up by the countries you mentioned, by the states, by the client states, by the head office, it's easy to get lost in this because there's so much to uncover and bring back to people so they can actually understand the reality of what's going on in their very eyes. But like you said, it gets whitewashed by the great media that we are, especially in England. But I like the way you introduced the term cold peace. I think that's a great term to use. And, Ord Wingate, I think that's a great someone to Google, especially for me. Maybe it's time to go around England and look at some of the statues that are up and see what they had to do with the cause of creating these pitiful situation that the Palestinians find themselves in through no fault of their own whatsoever. So thank you, Mick, again for that. Our final speaker, I know we've run on, but again, I think you'll forgive me for taking the liberty, allowing people to carry on, because I think what's being said is so important. And I mean, I'm getting messages through the channels here, and there's people watching from Kenya, from Canada, from Australia, from Algeria, from other parts of the Middle East, and sending messages of support. And so thank you to all of you. And we probably won't have the questions and answers, we'll wrap up. But before we do all that, our final speaker today, talking about something which is really relevant, and the chair of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, who convened this webinar together with other organizations, Brother Massoud Shadjareh. It's one of the most long-standing Muslim organizations in the United Kingdom. And he'll speak about how the Zionist lobby have successfully infiltrated Muslim organizations. And I think it's very important to learn from that, because if it's happened here, it's happening elsewhere. So Brother Massoud, thank you so much for your contributions and joining us. Thank you.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Sorry, can you hear me?
We can hear you, Massoud. We can't see your camera. If you could switch your camera on. You look much better than that icon that came up.
I have...
If you want to spend a minute trying to get your camera sorted. And, as Brother Massoud, chair of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, topic will be basically normalization through Muslim organizations, especially in England. And I think I can just make a couple of comments on this. This is what's going on. It's desensitization of the Muslim community en masse. And I suppose what they're selling us is a dream of being able to carry on living here. We can carry on getting jobs and promotions and so on and so forth in what we do as people of Muslim origin in the UK slowly start progressing within different fields, so on and so forth. The more and more they have to tighten the lips on what they're saying on the issue of Palestine, and if you say anything, the Zionists will be very good at getting you brought up and trying to get you prosecuted by all sorts of riffraff out there. But yeah, I think it's important for us, and even the talks that we've listened to through the afternoon, by Dr. Marwa Osman, by the Reverend Stephen, by Professor Ayman, by Mick, it shows you that when it comes to the issue of Palestine, it's, you know, cross-sectional. There's loads of areas we've got to cover. This wasn't an overnight project that just happened, as the speakers have said. This was planned, and it's continuously being planned. And as Mick quite right, he said about the way they're using client states now, and that even though their main client state is, will always be Israel, because they don't trust, actually, they don't even trust the Arabs. The Arabs are putting so much trust and the Americans, yet the Americans don't trust the Arabs. So that's the way, and I'm talking about the leadership here. Great, good to have you, Brother Massoud, with us. As I said, the Islamic Human Rights Commission is actually convening this talk and webinar, and it's great, thanks to them. And Brother Massoud, over to you on normalization through Muslim organizations.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, really, it's been a fantastic experience listening to all the previous contributors. And there is an issue of being the last speaker, and it's fortunate because everything that needs to be said more or less has been said. But also sometimes people say it's also fortunate because I could say anything and nobody could dispute me afterward. But on a serious note, there is a huge concern. The way that there has been a policy of the Zionists to normalize themselves in all different arenas. We heard on normalization within the Christian community, the way that normalization and infiltration into other institutions like Labour Party and indeed some of the unions, et cetera, et cetera. But there has been a tremendous effort put in to normalize within the Muslim community in the last few years. And you could see sort of the discussions prior to that on why there should be a normalization. And there are many Zionists who are agents of normalization have written quite extensively that they argue that the way that the normalization took place within the churches and the Christian community, one of the benefits of it was that it made them it made it much more difficult for the clergy and the churches to speak out against the atrocities committed by Israelis. And that relationship has managed to sort of mellow things out and indeed sort of move towards sort of acceptance of the Zionist institutions, despite the brutal activities of Israel and despite the fact that unquestionably the Zionist institution support all the atrocities committed by Israel, and they always find excuses for those atrocities and those illegal, brutal occupation. Now, as I said, there are a lot of materials that, you know, the same thing should happen within the Muslim world, and the institution of interfaith was used as one of the tools for this. And you know, you could ask yourself, you could look into it, why is it that all the Jewish organizations who are involved in interfaith are actually Zionists? While we know there is a huge number of anti-Zionists, non-vote Zionists, Jewish community, and none of them are represented. But also, you know, we have seen the whole process of inviting sort of Muslim clergy to go to occupied Palestine as a guest of Israeli government, as a guest of the Zionist institution, as a guest of these institutions which have set up for this particular reason. And, you know, we've seen this happening despite the fact that overwhelming majority of Muslims, and indeed majority of most people who know what's going on in occupied Palestine, are supporters of Palestinians. And some of the papers which have been written by these champions of normalization, they actually say that if we go and process our normalization, while the Muslims currently are 85 to 95% pro-Palestinian, if you could actually reduce that to 75, 65, whatever number, that is actually the value of this process. So what they do, they go and they sort of get involved, they start saying wonderful things, you know, about the Muslim community. They try to be champions of standing up for the right of Muslims on issues like Islamophobia. They try to sort of say they're anti-racist, you know, people who are supporting the racism and the apartheid system of occupied territories. They are now suddenly become anti-racist. And they also say that they are able to open doors for certain people. They see themselves and they act as gatekeepers to power, gatekeepers to British government, gatekeepers to media. And indeed, they sort of do this process very vigorously. They promote anyone who becomes pro-Zionist, and they sort of campaign against anyone who is pro-Palestinians. So what we see suddenly the sort of clergies that were speaking out against injustices in occupied territories by getting involved with these agents bit by bit, you know, within a very short time, they go completely silent on injustices that are taking place. And they start sort of behaving, and you know, one of them in particular wrote a little piece of bio of himself in the Wolf Institute, which is one of these institutions which actually is there for normalization. And he said that he wants to spend his life on addressing the misunderstanding between Muslims and Jews in Middle East. What misunderstanding? You know, these people have taken their land. People, Palestinians, are still with the front door key to their homes, are deprived. They are actually being pushed into Gaza, which is a huge concentration camp, or elsewhere in Lebanon or in Syria and elsewhere, living an exile life. And then even once in a while, they get attacked again. You remember, we'll be coming to the anniversary of Sabra and Shatila. You know, these were people who run away the massacres, like what happened in occupied Palestine when village by village were attacked. There, Yassin, you remember? You know, they massacred people. They allowed some to survive, to go and tell the tale so it would help the ethnic cleansing process. And these people who survived those massacres went to places like Lebanon and in those camps. And then when the Israelis invaded Lebanon, Sabra and Shatila was turned into the bloodbath with their approval, with their knowledge, under their control. And that was nothing but the final solution. You can't call that anything else. This wasn't even part of the process of ethnic cleansing. These people were already cleansed from their own land. You know, the brutality that the Zionists behave, and if you have any illusion about what the Zionism's ideology is, just look at the current or the new ambassador Zionist state ambassador to Britain. Just read what she says. She says it exactly as they believe. She says that there should be no embarrassment. This is our land in totality, and we will take it and we will control it. So if we are doing normalization, you're normalizing with these people. We're normalizing brutality of Zionism. We're normalizing the racism and the ethnic cleansing. We're normalizing the apartheid system. We're normalizing the fact that, you know, people are not even able to put their lives together. Look what is happening in Gaza. The children of Gaza are one of the most deprived children in the world. In today's world, you know, when we look at what is happening in Bahrain and Emirates, this is because these countries, these rulers have become so weak because they don't have the support of their own people. Because they don't have the support of their own people for their survival, they actually have to be enslaved into the Zionists and to the Americans. You know, Trump says it very nicely. Look, if you're not there, you're not going to survive for a week. That is the reality. These nations, if you call it that, they are becoming sort of selling out on humanity, selling out to their fellow Arab, fellow Muslim, right? They're selling out the opinion of their own population. And they know what they're doing is wrong, but they do it because they're so weak, because they have got no other option. They have sold out everything to the West, and their survival, their personal survival, and their family survival depends on it. But I've got news for them. This actually proves that their days are outnumbered. This proves that sooner or later, these rulers are going to fall one by one, because history shows us this is exactly what happens. They think they are ensuring their future. As a matter of fact, they're doing exactly opposite. And when it comes to the Muslim community here, I think also it is partially true that these Muslim leaders who are going to the Zionists to sort of so they will be in the glory and acceptability of the institutions, they also are weak. They are weak in their belief. They are weak in the constitution of understanding and standing for what is right and what is just. They are weak, and if they weren't weak, they wouldn't have done this. No man who believes and has got dignity and believes in his dignity will actually sell out ordinary innocent civilians to be slaughtered in this way and to legitimize those who are committing this systematically. So really what we need to do, we need to stand up for what is just. As a Muslim, and I make no bones about it, I actually believe Islam is the solution. As a Muslim, we are told to stand up against injustice, even stand up as a witness, even against ourselves, against the rich, against the poor, against our brothers, against our friends. Stand up for what is just and be witness. As a Muslim, we can't sort of become part of the oppression. As a Muslim, we have to stand up and be confident in ourselves to be able to stand to what is right. As a Muslim, the hadith, the saying of the Prophet, peace be upon him, says that if you see something which is wrong, first try to change it by your hand. If you couldn't do it, try to change it by your tongue. If you couldn't do that, hate it in your heart. Why is that? Because you cannot become part of the wrong thing. You cannot normalize the wrong that is happening. You cannot become ally to this injustice. The least of the level of belief is to hate it in your heart, i.e. don't be part of it. But the first thing is try to change it physically, get involved. I want to invite all of you, Muslims, people of other faiths, and indeed people of none. We need to unite. We have to struggle. We have to move forward. We have to stand up for what is just. And together, all of us, using our ability and our strength, we could do this through BDS, through standing up and speaking the truth. Speak the truth to the power. And the best place you could do it is to stand up against this oppressive Zionist ideology, which is destroying not just the Palestinian Muslims and Christian, but I believe they also destroy the soul of those who believe in Judaism, and they're actually enslaving their own community because they are creating almost a prison out of what is called Israel. Let us bring justice. Let us actually bring justice for everyone, so everyone could stand and live together. And the first thing we need to do for that purpose is stand up against Zionism, as is a sort of a disease, which in heart of it, it believes in destroying other people's life, taking their land, and dismissing their legitimate rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that very important and educative talk, and also a passionate talk as well. So thank you so much. I mean, you talked on the interfaith, how the Zionists have penetrated, especially in the UK. It's one of their trains into different communities, using the interfaith to legitimize the goings on by the state of Israel. You spoke about how you know, even they work in fractions, 65-75% of Muslims. If that was the only number of people supporting the Palestinian cause in the UK, they can live with that. That'll be fine. You also went on to talk about the Wolf Institute and other institutes that exist, and the way the people there who call themselves Muslims, and for that matter are, but the way they behave, and how it's all down to the lack of faith, genuine belief, genuine self-confidence. And obviously, how can we forget the children of Gaza? And as you've said right at the end, we have to speak truth to power regardless of. So thank you, Brother Massoud, for that. We don't have, unfortunately, time for any questions. However, I am going to ask the panel for 60 seconds maximum on one thing. And I'd like for them to answer it based on their backgrounds, because I think it's important for us to hear, because the Palestinian cause unites people of all faiths, Muslims, Christians, Jews, people of no faiths as well, and people all different colors, all different nationalities. It brings us all together on one platform of common human dignity. And that one question is, after seeing what's going on, it can be easy for some people, genuine people who care for the Palestinians, to think, how do we carry on? How do we not lose hope? So if I could ask, to start with Reverend Stephen, if I could ask you, Stephen, from Christian teachings, if you will, please, if I can ask you to tell us why it's important for us not to lose hope and to stand with the truth. If you could unmute yourself, Stephen, please.
What does the Lord require of us but to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God? We must commit ourselves to non-violent resistance and to overcome evil, not with more evil, not with more violence, but with good. So we must, dare I say, we've got to love our Zionist friends, but at the same time speak truth to power and show solidarity with our Palestinian sisters and brothers, and not allow this normalization to continue without resistance. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend. Thank you so much. If I can ask Dr. Marwa, as you've spoken passionately about the Islamic resistance, which the Israelis are facing, if you can, again, the same question, why we mustn't lose hope and why we must stand with what's right. Is Dr. Marwa with us? Okay, before we come back to Dr. Marwa, if I could ask Mick Napier, who's you know, committed activist. As an activist, as someone who stands in the rain, in the wind, who turns up to all these events standing for truth, there are, like I said, people out there who perhaps do think, oh, this normalization is going on. How do we, you know, how are we going to win this? How is it important as an activist not to lose hope and stand for what's right? Mick, 60 seconds, please.
The Americans invaded Vietnam, killed 3 million people and were driven out by resistance. The French were driven out of Algeria. Brits were driven out of Aden, South Yemen. When some London activists put some posters up on the London tube, the metro, Netanyahu had his ambassador complain to the British Prime Minister. A few posters. They try to pretend they're invulnerable, but they have an Achilles heel. They are weak. They are very, very unpopular regime. And I think the rise of the boycott, divestment and sanctions movement over the last 12 years has been faster than its equivalent against apartheid South Africa. I have no doubt whatsoever that ultimately Zionism is unsustainable. It will implode. It will be defeated from outside. And it will also come up against the indomitable resistance of the Palestinian people.
Thank you very much. Mick, thank you for that, for your contribution and for your continuous stance that you do, and an inspiration to all of us. And finally, if I could ask Brother Massoud, you know, you touched on a lot of points there in your talk about and the importance of speaking truth about. But as a Muslim, as you know, used that reference as well yourself, as a Muslim, why we mustn't lose hope and why we should always stand with the right?
The justice will prevail, and this is a promise by God, and is not just to Muslims. Is you could see the same sentiment being sort of echoed in Christianity and Judaism, etc. The justice will prevail. What is really important is that, are we going to be part and parcel of that struggle for justice or not? I think we need to be part of that more than the Palestinians who need us to be part of it. I think if we normalized with brutality and injustice that the Zionism sort of demands, then we actually destroy ourselves. We destroyed our thinking. We destroy our soul. We destroy our humanity. So we need to stand up against Zionism, and we need to do it together with our colleagues from the Jewish community and the Christian community and people of sort of who are atheists or anyone else, because the fact is, injustice is injustice. You know, even a 10-year-old child understands the concept of justice and injustice. And we need to be on the right side of it. And we need to become confident we do this. And, you know, this thing that the Zionists are becoming the gatekeepers, this thing that, you know, they're going around and selling sort of a position and power and so forth. The fact that the Zionists have got together with the concept of anti-terror laws and everything else to social engineer, be part of that social engineering and sort of remove the concept of justice from us as Muslims and indeed as others, we need to resist it and resist it together, and we will be victorious.
Thank you, Brother Massoud. And finally, we're very pleased to announce we got Dr. Marwa back. Dr. Marwa, finally, if you could conclude with why we mustn't lose hope and why we must always stand for the truth and with the people on the right.
it's a matter of life and death, to be honest with you. When you choose to stand with the righteous people, it's like you standing with yourself at the end of the day instead of standing with the worst version of yourself. What I mean is, if we hadn't had the international support that we did have, especially the regional support in Lebanon, we wouldn't have been able to deter the occupation and resist until we got our land back, we got our detainees back, every last detainee and every last body of our hero fighters was returned to Lebanon. Because we had this support, we had the support from our regional friends and international friends, as well as the steadfastness of our resistance, you cannot be except with what is right, because this is the innate behavior of humans. You cannot just stand aside and watch the houses of the Palestinians being demolished, watch young kids as young as 7 years old, the age of my eldest daughter, crying over her house being demolished in front of her face. You cannot just sit aside when you see incarcerated Palestinians, the righteous indigenous people of Palestine, suffering inside of detention centers, the worst detention centers made on this planet, the torture that they have to endure, the loss of family that they have to endure. You cannot stay silent when Gaza is carpet bombed every now and then, because Israel just wants to do that. They want to make the Palestinians suffer more while blockading them, naval blockade, land blockade, aerial blockade. How can you just be silent when such things happen? How can you be silent when the birthplace of Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, who is considered by many as the son of God and by many Muslims as the holy prophet, to see his birthplace be damaged and destroyed by Zionism, and you see that more than 50% of the Christians in Bethlehem have just picked up and left because of this human rights violations. How can you be silent when Palestinians cannot return home? They cannot see their loved ones. If they happen to leave Gaza after years of trying to leave Gaza, they are not allowed to come back. How can you be silent when every now and then Israel takes more land, incarcerates more people, annexes more land as if it's literally the owner of this land, when obviously they're nothing but colonial settlers? It's a choice that you make. You either do the right thing or you don't. And when you don't, mind you, you will feel bad.
Dr. Marwa, thank you so much for those words. Not only just... very important words and terms you use there, but it's actually very full of justice, full of love for your fellow human being is what drives you. Can I take this opportunity on behalf of the Islamic Human Rights Commission and on behalf of the other co-organizers of this and just thank every one of you who's been watching. And I can see, and I apologize, we couldn't get to any of the questions because there was so many coming through, and I know you've been watching it from across the world. Thank you so much for joining us on this really important webinar. We wish you safety. We wish you peace. Thank you to everyone behind the scenes who's helped put this together. And obviously, thank you to Dr. Marwa Osman. Thank you to Brother Massoud Shadjareh. Thank you to Reverend Stephen Sizer. Thank you to Mick Napier. And thank you to Professor Haim. Thank you all. May God bless you all. And we wish you a good and a happy weekend ahead, and hopefully we will one day all convene in Jerusalem together, drinking tea, brothers and sisters, arms in arms, and enjoying all our faiths together without any injustice, inshallah. Thank you so much.